Kia ora tātou. As Alistair said, my name's John Allen. I'm a member of the community here at St John's, and can I add my welcome to Alistair's welcome. It's great to see you all here. It's particularly good to see David and his wife Jeannie with us and to have a chance to engage with them over the course of the evening. You know, as I sat in the church, I came early specifically for this purpose. I felt the sense of excitement build as people came into the church this evening. I think in part that's because some of you heard David preach on Sunday, navigating disputable matters under Christ's leadership, and were riveted. And those of you that would be riveted if you'd heard him can still listen to that sermon. It's on the St. John's website, and it is really good listening. Others of you will be really animated because you understand the books that David has written and his other writings, and you've been impressed by that and you want to hear more. Even more of you will recognise that this is a man with more letters after his name than just about anyone else on the planet. And so he can stand and speak about Christian ethics with real authority. For me, there are two things that I thought were really exciting about David being here tonight. The first is he describes himself as an activist. He describes himself as an activist. He co-wrote the Evangelical Climate Initiative. He's co-written the Declaration Against Torture. He is an academic Christian churchman who understands that thinking without action is largely a waste of time. So he is an activist. He understands the importance of acting in our community. But most importantly, he's standing and speaking from a Christian perspective. And as you know, in our society, Christians and Christian thinking is often marginalized on the basis that we're some sort of mystical sect responsible for bad science and sort of outmoded morality. You and I know, or many of us know, that in fact the Christian message, and particularly the Christian ethical message, grounded as it is in the gospel, which is radically inclusive, which is radically egalitarian, which is radically loving, and informed by 2,000 years of lived experience, not just by scholars and academics, although there have been heaps of them, but by saints and ordinary people and ordinary lives. We know that the Christian perspective is a valid and animating and informed perspective. It's particularly so when it's presented by someone with the credentials of David Gushee, and I'm delighted to welcome you, David, and invite you to address us.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for such a kind introduction. I have never been introduced as well as I have been introduced in New Zealand. Kiwi hospitality, and but people who've been thinking and studying what I've been trying to do in my work, it's an honor. So thank you, and thank you so much, so many of you, for coming this evening. So in the first lecture, I spoke about the Holocaust. In the second lecture, I spoke about Christian witness in public life, and I focused on the issue of torture undertaken by the United States government and the effort of myself and a number of people to respond with analysis and resistance and to equip the saints, you might say, in our country to say no. Tonight, I am going to move to a different kind of reflection, though I think by the end you'll definitely see the connections. And it's a reflection on Jesus himself. The lecture is called Remembering Jesus and the Task of Christian Ethics. So ultimately, as a Christian ethicist, everything that I do is grounded in a specific understanding of Scripture, understanding of Jesus, and understanding of what Jesus was about in his ministry. So this lecture will focus especially on what Jesus meant when he came preaching the kingdom of God. So we're going to be thinking about the kingdom of God in particular. And I'll be working through themes of a book that I co-authored some years ago called Kingdom Ethics, that I notice is fairly widely read among the theological students here in New Zealand, which is awesome. And I should say, for everybody who's listening, the second edition of Kingdom Ethics will be out next spring after 13 years in a first edition. So, and it will be, I think, much improved. But the same basic reading of scripture and moral vision that was in first edition will be in this next one. So how do we remember Jesus? How do we take seriously what the historical Jesus was about in his own context, and then what that means for us in our particular context 2,000 years later? That's the question. My work, theologically, is grounded in the concept of the kingdom of God. Biblical scholar Gordon Fee has written, "The universal witness of the synoptic tradition is that the absolutely central theme of Jesus' mission and message was the good news of the kingdom of God." The centrality of this theme is highlighted in such texts as Matthew 4:17. Oh, look. I'll give you a quiz after this. So the bold terms are the ones you want to be written. No quiz, I promise. Okay. The centrality of the theme is highlighted in the very early texts of both Matthew and Mark. For example, in Matthew 4:17, in which the first words that we get out of Jesus' mouth in the beginning of his public ministry are, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." And then also in Mark 1:14-15, which reads, "Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news.'" In Kingdom Ethics, the textbook I just mentioned, we make the crucial decision to follow the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and the scholarly consensus about the centrality of the kingdom of God theme in the work of the historical Jesus. And we make the kingdom of God the central category in our approach to Christian ethics. This is something that is often not done. In fact, we say early in the book that most Christian ethics textbooks say very little about the kingdom of God, and do not ground their approach in the kingdom of God anything like what we ended up deciding to do. So if we focus on the kingdom of God theme and make it central for Christian ethics, then certain related questions must be answered, such as, what exactly is the kingdom of God? What did Jesus mean by this phrase when he used it? Actually, sometimes when I teach my classes on this, I say, okay, first thing, I may do this fall back in the States. First thing, you have 30 seconds, write down what the phrase kingdom of God actually means. Often it's one of those phrases that is one of those churchy phrases that people really have no particular content of what that means. They have no idea. So we're definitely going to try to fix that by the end of this conversation, at least anyway. So. What exactly is the kingdom of God? What did Jesus mean when he used that language? When is the kingdom of God? What time does it arrive? Where is the kingdom of God? Where might we go to find it? And then, of course, how do we know any of this? If I were to give a longer address, I would speak a little bit more about the problem of pinpointing the historical questions. What did Jesus mean by kingdom of God, and what did the gospel writers make of Jesus' proclamation of the kingdom of God? And how did the kingdom of God message connect to what was being taught in first century Judaism at the time and before Jesus came as well? And some of these themes will be reflected on this evening. So let's begin with the idea of what is the kingdom of God? The kingdom of God, at one level, is a theological vision. It's a certain way, a God-centered way of looking at the world. Or we might say, it's a part of a particular story that Christians and Jews have believed about the relationship between God and the world. The kingdom of God idea is rooted in the broad biblical claim that there is a God, and this God is the rightful king over all the earth, over all creation, over all the universe, because God is the creator and sovereign of all. But the kingdom of God idea is also rooted in the broad experience that the world is not as it should be, that the world is in sinful rebellion against God, in alienation from God, that we do not live in the best of all possible worlds, that something is terribly wrong. And so the kingdom of God, in a sense, tells a more complex story about a world that God made, a world over which God is king, but a world in which the, you might say, the subjects of the king are in rebellion and are making a horrible mess because of the rebellion that we have brought into the world. So that's some background. Also, the kingdom of God theme is inextricably Jewish. It is rooted in the particular narrative of Israel, the Jewish people, the narrative of a God who, of all the peoples of the earth, chose Israel, who made a covenant with Israel, who was in relationship with Israel, and yet a people sent into exile, at least on one interpretation, as punishment for their covenant breaking. A people subjugated, scattered in diaspora from their homeland, yearning for redemption, yearning to go home, yearning for God to act to set things right. It's a Jewish narrative, and Jesus was a part of the Jewish people and reflects this Jewish narrative. And the kingdom of God idea is rooted in interpretations of Israel's scriptures, which we call the Old Testament, Christians do, and the and Hebrew Bible is another way to describe the sacred texts that in various places promise a day or a time when God will act in judgment and in redemption. The technical word for this in theology is eschatology, a vision of the future, a vision of God's interruption and intervention in human history, in Israel's history, to bring salvation and rescue and redemption. So the kingdom of God concept is a deeply Jewish concept that Jesus came preaching, and I think it's interesting to deal with attention from the beginning that the very Jewishness of the kingdom of God concept has often led Christians to one of two options. One is to ignore the kingdom of God altogether. Another is to strip it out of its original Jewish context and to have it lose any contact with what would have originally been understood by the Jewish listeners of the message of Jesus. In kingdom ethics, we argue for the centrality of the prophet Isaiah in shaping Jesus' understanding of and teaching about the kingdom. We have text after text that we cite where we notice Jesus either quoting this text or alluding to these texts in his proclamation of his own message. But other texts from the Hebrew Bible, Old Testament, are also clearly influential, including from Psalms and other places. And Jesus is creative in his reworking of the themes of the Hebrew Bible. So, continuing to zero in, one way to move next is to say, the kingdom of God is a state of affairs on earth in which God at last reigns without further resistance. That's the kingdom of God. And in that sense, that's what Jesus taught us, his followers, to pray for when in the Lord's Prayer we have that famous line, Jesus says, pray in this way, and then, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So the kingdom of God looks like a state of affairs in which God's will is done on earth as it is in heaven. We wouldn't have to pray for it if it were already a present reality. If it didn't matter, we wouldn't bother to pray for it. It's a prayer soaked in a yearning for God, who is the rightful ruler of the world, to be obeyed at last, for God to reign as king without resistance. These are monarchical images. Some people don't like monarchical images in our egalitarian time. But we have God the king and a world in rebellion against God and a world making a mess of itself because of the rebellion. And finally, the kingdom of God looks like that time or state of affairs in which the rightful ruler of the world is finally obeyed at last, comprehensively, in which there is no more rebellion, no more resistance, and therefore no more suffering caused by human beings because of our rebellion against God. This is what the redemption of the world is about, and it's a far broader message than what sometimes Christians have made of the message of Jesus, solely a message of personal redemption and personal salvation. So, sifting through the Old Testament witness and the life and example and teachings of Jesus in kingdom ethics, we propose seven marks of the kingdom. This is always on every test every year that I give my students. You're definitely going to want to memorize these, okay? If you've got children with you, test them on this when you go back home, all right? So what we're saying by the seven marks of the kingdom is these are the themes that consistently surface in Jesus' teaching and in his ministry and also in the backdrop text from Isaiah especially. So this is at least our proposal, to give some content to what the kingdom of God actually means. If you say, seek the kingdom, or we want the kingdom to come, or if you pray, God, bring your kingdom, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, this is what it looks like. So we propose seven marks or characteristics of the kingdom. When the kingdom of God comes, these things begin to happen. So, first, deliverance. And you'll notice, by the way, an interesting built-in tension here between hopes that are specific to Israel in a first century context or a later Jewish context and hopes that are broadened in Christian thought. So they'll both be there. But deliverance, or the synonym salvation, holistically understood, is when God delivers Israel or people from grave distress. It's rescue, it's saving from death and destruction, it's saving from alienation from God, it's saving from enemies, it's being rescued. We've turned that word salvation, again, exclusively into a spiritual thing. But deliverance, which means rescue, which means salvation, has to do with a comprehensive rescue by God of somebody who is in deep distress, or of a world that is in deep distress. Secondly, we suggest that a second mark of the kingdom is peace. The kingdom looks like, finally, people stop killing each other. People stop making war on each other. Israel stops being attacked and slaughtered by its enemies in the Old Testament perspective. But in general, human beings beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks, and they stop killing each other. Until killing ceases, we are not in the kingdom of God. But all kinds of Old Testament promises, and then echoes in Jesus' teaching and echoes later in the New Testament, speak of a time when all of this war and all of this killing will stop. So, and you see these are connected. For a people who find themselves regularly destroyed or attacked or threatened by war, deliverance from war, which means peace, this is the kingdom of God. At least that's what it is, part of what it means for them. So deliverance and peace. Third, the kingdom looks like justice. It looks like an end to all of the wretched oppression, injustice, and subjugation, humiliation, oppression of one group by another, of one class by another, of the powerless by the powerful. The kingdom of God looks like justice. And in Old Testament perspective, justice doesn't just mean a kind of a thin understanding like fairness, and it doesn't just mean like retribution for crime. Justice means that those who have their faces ground into the dust every day are finally lifted up. They are finally set free from their subjugation and oppression. Those who have been bullied are no longer bullied. Those who have been rendered powerless are no longer powerless. Those who have been abused are no longer abused. I think that we have the best way to gain access to what the Bible means by justice and justice as a mark of the kingdom of God is to think about somebody you know or a time in your own life in which you were the victim of injustice. And think of the people that their regular condition of life is a condition of being victimized by injustice. The kingdom of God looks like that finally ends. And justice reigns, and there is no more subjugation or domination of one group by another. And no more humiliation, and no more brutalization, and no more abuse. No more of that. A fourth mark of the kingdom is healing. And you have, again, Old Testament prophecies and New Testament fulfillment, both teaching and action. Notice, remember when Jesus was asked by the disciples of John the Baptist, are you the one to come or should we look for another? And Jesus says, basically, look around you. You know, the lame walk and the blind see and the deaf hear and the poor have good news preached to them. Healing here can have both a physical and a spiritual or metaphorical meaning. When the kingdom comes, all of our physical brokenness finally gets addressed. And all of our spiritual brokenness and illness or disease gets addressed as well. Whether broken by war or hunger or illness or famine or addiction or disease. Healing, you know, no more of this distress. The kingdom looks like a time when healing finally happens. Fifth, the kingdom has a community dimension. In the Old Testament passages, a lot of times, what this means is that the dispersed Jewish community that has been sent off into exile is set free and is able to return home. The prisoners have the shackles taken off of them and they're able to return to their families. Those who have been separated from community are welcome at the table of community. Those who have been exiled are allowed to go back home. So words like liberation and inclusion and return mark a lot of Old Testament language about this mark of the reign of God. Captives being set free, the dispersed being allowed to go home at last. But especially in Jesus' ministry, it took a broader meaning having to do with all of those who were outcast being welcome. Those who didn't have a place at the table having a place at the table. Those who had been excluded being not excluded anymore. Think about the way Jesus treated like women and children, Gentiles and tax collectors and the sick and the bleeding and so on. All were welcome, all were to be included in the... So community is a dimension of the kingdom of God. It's the building of a certain kind of community in Israel, in the church, and in the world. A community in which everybody has a place at the table, in which human hatreds and divisions are overcome, in which the walls we have built to separate us from one another come down, in which genuine community prevails. We go on to say, I think it was back here, that when God acts to bring his kingdom, it involves a remarkable experience of God's intervention, God's presence. By the time of the first century, Israel had been suffering for a long period in which Israel felt that God had been absent. Where is God? Where are the prophets? Where is God's action to liberate us from Roman rule, to set our homeland free, to restore and renew his people? When God acts to bring his kingdom, we sense God's presence after a long absence. The imagery of light is often used in the Old Testament and the New Testament to point to the experience of God's radiant presence. Light dawns. The gloom is broken through. God shows up in doing all of these acts of the kingdom. And all of this results in the experience of joy. because God is vividly present and is delivering and is bringing peace and justice and healing and liberation and return and joyful community, people do respond with joy. Look at the response to Jesus' ministry. It was always, so often, a response of joy. You know, think about those who were healed and those who are welcomed. The joy, the celebration, the promise of joy is fulfilled in Jesus. So the claim that we make in kingdom ethics is that when Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven has come near, or cognate, the kingdom of God is breaking in, that this is what he's talking about. He's saying that God is now acting to intervene in this world to bring deliverance, peace, justice, healing, restored or rebuilt community. God's all through God's loving and powerful dynamic presence with a response of joy being what inevitably follows when God acts in this way. I think that this is what's also going on in the famous inaugural address in Luke chapter 4, which is one of the most, I think, significant passages in the whole kingdom account. Just read you just a section of this. Those who pay attention to this theme always return to this passage. When he came to Nazareth, Luke 4:16, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah, not a coincidence, was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Do you see all the marks of the kingdom already in that passage? Healing, deliverance for the poor, release for the captives, freedom for the oppressed, and the year of the Lord's favor, speaking either to a Jubilee reference or even to the day of the Lord or end of days reference. He rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." Anybody could read Isaiah, but not anybody, or just anybody, would dare to say, "Today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The kingdom is dawning. Something is happening. We know, if you know the Bible, that what happens after this is he ends up in a conflict with the people there in his hometown. And it appears to be over the breadth and reach of the kingdom, whether it will be extended to the Gentiles and not just to the Jews. And he ends up beloved in like verse 20 and about to be thrown off a hill by verse 30. The kingdom preaching is not always very popular. So, all right. So let's move on. So the claim so far is that the kingdom of God is at the heart of Jesus' preaching, and that Jesus, as a son of Israel, rooted in the biblical materials that he would have known and loved, and in knowing a tradition that was already at work in his time, came preaching the good news that the day of deliverance, long promised for Israel and maybe also for the world, was dawning in him. And that leads to the second question. Well, when is it going to happen? What did Jesus say? The verb tenses here are really delicate sometimes and not always consistent with each other. And a lot has to do with how everything is translated into English. So, for example, you have the time is fulfilled. Does that mean the kingdom is fully realized right now at the beginning of Jesus' ministry? Probably not. You have it is on its way. It has come near. So is this more like it's around the corner? It's just coming, but not here yet? Many have been confused by the English translation of Luke 17:21. The kingdom of God is within you, is how it was translated in some translations. And that led to an overly personalized or spiritualized reading. Probably better to read that as it is in your midst. You can catch glimpses of it now. It's breaking in, or even among you. Or with Jesus teaching us to pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done," it would clearly seem to indicate that it isn't quite here yet. If it were here, we wouldn't have to pray for it. We put it all together in kingdom ethics to suggest that the kingdom of God, and this is delicate, but it is both something that we wait for and something that we work for. Something that we can catch glimpses of, but something that is not quite here yet, at least not in its fullness. And so the text, "Seek first the kingdom of God," summarizes the active questing, working, but also seeking and waiting that are all part of this kingdom life. Different readings of the New Testament tend to produce different results in Christian community when it comes to the kingdom. For example, if the kingdom is already fully here, or if the kingdom is entirely off into the future, then the concept of the kingdom of God doesn't really have any ethical implications. If it's already fully here, there's nothing to do. If it's entirely off into the future, there's nothing we can do until Jesus comes back. That's why I think that those are actually pretty destructive ways of understanding the timing of the kingdom. But if we read the evidence, to say that the kingdom of God has dawned, it has been inaugurated, it has started, but it is not yet here in its fullness. We can see glimpses of it. It's breaking in like the early dawn of a new day, but it's not fully day yet. This makes better sense of the real world that we actually live in. It gives us something to look forward to. And if we have some kind of role in it, it gives followers of Jesus something very important to do. And that's the posture that we take in kingdom ethics, and that I believe very, very strongly, that what Jesus intended to teach was a kind of a what's called inaugurated eschatology, or inaugurated kingdom eschatology. It's like the reign of the king has been inaugurated, has been announced, but it has not yet been fulfilled. Maybe like the difference between an election and an inauguration. Or there's a gap. Something has begun, but it is not quite completed, or certainly not here in its fullness. This is sometimes described as the already and not yet tension of Christian ethics and of Christian eschatology. So if the kingdom of God has been initiated in Christ, but will not be fulfilled until the end of time, until Christ returns, then we live in an in-between time, where we have plenty to do, but we're also waiting for what God and only God can do. It's paradoxical, it's dynamic, and it's frustrating. We're working for a kingdom that we can't see the end results of. We're waiting for Christ to return, and we don't know when he'll come back. We've got things to do while we wait. That's a lot of people are looking at it in this way now, and perhaps our book has played a role, but there are others who are doing the same thing. So, there's another question here that I think is important. It's really who is responsible for all of this? And we make a both and move. We suggest that Jesus teaches that the kingdom of God is something that God is doing, but we are partnering with God in that work. Another way to say this is that God performs the kingdom, but we who love God choose to participate in what God is doing. And both are grace. It is grace that God would act to save this rebellious world. And it is grace that we have some role in that work. And so this is how that role, that what we do part of it, this is where you're getting some ethics, where you get some ethical opportunity, an ethical obligation. Because if the kingdom of God is breaking in and it looks like justice and peace and a new kind of community and healing and deliverance for those who are in distress, and we have a role in that, then we have a moral agenda to pursue. We've got work to do. And that work is ours to do until Jesus returns. That's kingdom ethics. So where then is the kingdom? Christians have often struggled with this. At least for now, I would say, the dawning kingdom is taking place right here on this earth. We are a participant in a divinely initiated drama of reclaiming this rebellious world. But there's an objection. What about when Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world"? Does that throw it back over to heaven? The response, I think, is to understand that what Jesus was saying there is, my kind of kingdom is not like this world's kingdoms. I don't rule the way you rule, Pilate. That's who he was talking to. But my kingdom is indeed happening here, and there is a clash between different kinds of kingdoms, and there always has been on this planet. So Jesus came preaching the kingdom. This means the kingdom is located here, right here among us. It has been inaugurated, but it has not been fully realized yet. We know this because any world that has war, torture, rape, violence, injustice, mass imprisonment, and misery of all types is not yet the realized kingdom of God. We often see the negation of the seven marks of the kingdom. Everything I've just proposed as to what God is doing in the world is it seems sometimes on the run, it's backpedaling, it's the opposite. And I think this is one reason why Jesus teaches in the Beatitudes, blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are those who mourn a world where instead of deliverance, we have captivity. Instead of peace, we have war. Instead of justice, we have injustice, and so on. So this creates a tension in Christianity that we've been dealing with since the very beginning of our tradition. How do we correlate the deeply unredeemed, unkingdom of God realities of the world around us with the message of Jesus that the kingdom of God is dawning, it's breaking in, it's just around the corner, and we have responsibilities to participate in it? I think that the gap or the tension between the kingdom of God as we understand what it's supposed to be like and the world that we actually live in often tempts Christians into some moves that are not terribly constructive. A lot of Christian history can be read as a response to this tension. For example, sometimes what we do with the kingdom of God message is to completely spiritualize it. Where do you find the kingdom? It's right here in my soul when I feel close to Jesus. A spiritualized kingdom is a way of just completely evading the world dimension of it, and it's just kind of me and Jesus. How many hymns, in so many traditions are me and Jesus kinds of hymns, right? People may be being murdered in the streets, but I feel peace in my heart right now, and I'm happy all the day and all of that, right? So spiritualizing the kingdom is in a sense a way of reducing the tension with the deeply unjust realities of this world by not paying attention to them anymore and by making the kingdom message all about me and Jesus. Another problem, I think, is to turn the kingdom into the church. And I like the church. This is a fine church, but I think even Reverend Alistair Lane would agree that the kingdom of God does not equal the work of a local congregation or even all the local congregations put together. The church is to be that place where the kingdom of God is pursued. But sometimes people equate like, okay, how do you know the kingdom is advancing? Because we have baptisms and a lot of money in our offering plate. That's not the kingdom of God. Those are means to advance the kingdom of God. Baptisms mean people are coming into a relationship with Christ and now they're going to be put to work on the battlefield of the kingdom, you might say. And the money provides funding for that. But that's a means to an end, not an end in itself, in my view. I don't think Jesus was interested in gathering a bunch of people around him to say, I've got a bunch of people around me. He was gathering a bunch of people around him to advance the reign of God in the world. That's what disciples do. So the church does not equal the kingdom. The church is a part of the kingdom. It serves the kingdom, but it does not equal the kingdom. One move that Christians made in the heyday of our power was to identify the kingdom with a Christian state. So, Britannia with the Christian queen and the Christian king, whatever, that's the kingdom, right? Christian America, Christian New Zealand, if there ever was such a thing, right? Christian England, Christian Germany, the Christian Roman Empire, that's where the kingdom is. You see it because the state has adopted Christianity, a horrible mistake. But Christians have sometimes done this as well. And then when we lose political power, we think we've lost the kingdom, Or if the ruler claims Christianity, we think the kingdom has come and we have to excuse whatever the ruler does, which has been a big problem as well. Another move is to push the kingdom entirely off into the future, where the only time we speak of kingdom is in the future. When Jesus comes back, we have the kingdom. Until then, we just have something else. Then the last move that Christians sometimes make is to identify the kingdom with heaven. The kingdom is where we go when we die. Heaven. The kingdom equals heaven. I'm quite convinced that none of those five things is what Jesus meant by the kingdom. Not in my soul, not the church, not Christendom, not the future, and not heaven. So then, where is the kingdom if it's none of those places? We suggest in kingdom ethics that the kingdom can be found wherever God's will is being done on earth now, wherever God is ruling effectively as king now. These glimpses of the kingdom are not confined to the church, but the church is to be the leading community fully committed to advancing God's reign. So in other words, sometimes we see glimpses of the kingdom in a well-functioning church in which justice is being advanced and peace is being made and excluded people are being included and healing is being done. But we also see it other places where those things are happening as well. The kingdom is advancing when God's will is being done on earth as it is in heaven. If you want to know where to find the kingdom, look for breakthroughs in God's will being done. That's where we see the kingdom. And you see the kingdom in a participatory sense. The kingdom is visible in everybody who gives their life to participate in it now. So that is how you can say, you can look at a person and you can see, I see the kingdom advancing through the work and life of that person, or that couple, or that family, or that church, or that school, or that initiative, that relief and development program, that peacemaking initiative, that conflict resolution project, or whatever it might be, where you see the goals of the kingdom being pursued with skill and passion and effectiveness. The danger, of course, is to over-identify any particular thing that happens with God's reign. But and so sometimes Christians have made a mistake, like you have a peace agreement. Neville Chamberlain makes peace with Hitler in 1938 in Munich, right? Oh, the kingdom is being advanced, and we realize, 3 days later that it wasn't. So caution about identifying any particular historical development with the kingdom is important. But there's no getting around the idea that there are ethical practices that participate in the kingdom of God, and that is a lot of what Jesus teaches. He teaches us how to participate in the kingdom of God. We call this in our book incarnational discipleship. The kingdom is advanced when disciples seek to embody and practice the kingdom as we have seen it lived and taught by Jesus. So that is how we make sense of the moral teachings of Jesus, for example, in the Sermon on the Mount, like turn the other cheek and love your enemies and go and make peace and forgive those who abuse you and go the second mile and love your neighbor as yourself. These are the concrete things that Jesus teaches us that show us how to participate in the advance of God's reign. It can be very, very humble when you have a relationship that is broken and you go and you obey Jesus and you go and initiate a conversation to make peace and a friendship is restored and forgiveness is advanced. That's a kingdom victory. A marriage that is on the rocks and the people decide to try again, maybe with some help from counseling, that's a kingdom victory. Where there's violence in a relationship or a community and the violence is ended, that's a kingdom victory. And all of these things are part of what Jesus teaches, and those of his followers are those who are to be committed to them while also welcoming others who share the same goals. So Jesus always emphasized that he was interested far more in the obedient practice of his teachings than all kinds of words about him. It's those who do the will of the Father in heaven, not those who call him Lord, Lord, he says in Matthew 7. So faith is the beginning of this journey. It motivates these practices, but I'm pretty sure from a lifetime of studying the teachings of Jesus that what Jesus will evaluate each of us on at the end of life is not whether we said the right words, but whether we lived out the practices of the kingdom as he taught them. So let me close with a couple of reflections. I have a problem with Christians who don't take the world's evil seriously. There are some complacent Christians who just happen to have been born into privileged situations so that they can avoid taking the world's evil seriously because they never happened to them. I think that that is a far cry from the kind of Christianity that Jesus was talking about. And I don't see how it even comes close to connecting with what Jesus was about or the rest of the Bible as well. One way that helps me think that I'm on the right track here with this understanding of the kingdom of God is to go back to what happened in the early first century. This connects to the Holocaust lecture that I gave a couple days ago. Christians have often puzzled over why most Jewish people in the first century who knew about Jesus did not accept the claims about Jesus and did not become Christians. Why could Jews not accept, on the whole, that Jesus was the Messiah? In my talk the other night, I quoted Rabbi Irving Greenberg, who had such a deep impact on me as my dissertation advisor. He said this as well. This was a shock to a naive young Baptist when he first said it, when I first read it. He said, "Was Jesus the fulfillment of the biblical hope for a Messiah? To the overwhelming majority of Jews then and now who understood ultimate redemption to include the political, economic, and social liberation of humanity, the answer to this question was clearly no. Given the facts on the ground, this person was no Messiah." That's what Irving Greenberg says. And now what he goes on to say, I don't have it in my notes, but what he goes on to say is that Jesus was a failed Messiah. He attempted to be a Messiah and he was executed for his trouble. That's what happens to Messiahs. But in any case, Rabbi Greenberg says that there is no coherent Jewish hope of redemption that is not this worldly in the way that I've been talking about, political, economic, and social. And so Jesus comes and he's a crucified Messiah, and Rome is still in charge, and injustice still reigns, and violence still prevails, and so he could not have been the Messiah. That's what Irving Greenberg says. And what I say in response is that this is indeed one of the ultimate built-in challenges of the Christian faith. And it has been there from the very beginning. We believe that the Messiah promised to the Jewish people came, but the world was not transformed in its political, economic, and social realities on the whole. One response to this is to say that the Jewish people were looking for the wrong kind of Messiah. Or to say that it was never really about the transformation of the world. It was only ever about getting some people saved to go to heaven where they can, you know, live with Jesus forever. And many Christians make this move, but that's not really what Jesus is doing in his preaching, at least not in the Synoptic Gospels. So what we say instead in kingdom ethics is that Jesus obviously understood the untransformed nature of the world, but he invited a community around him who would participate in that transformation, who would embody that transformation, who would at least give glimpses of that transformation. He practiced this, he invited people to follow him, and after he was executed and resurrected and raised and ascended to heaven, this was the community that was left behind to do the work. And we are, if we are Christians, we are the descendants of that community. Jesus died in part because he fought for the kingdom in all the seven dimensions that I've mentioned, and this evoked opposition from the political authorities of his day and the religious authorities. His resurrection is God's vindication and promise of the ultimate coming of the kingdom, but we live in the shadow of the resurrection, but yet we do not live in a resurrected world yet. It again is a foreshadowing of what is to come. So what this leaves is an enormous responsibility for the church. The idea that Jesus inaugurated the kingdom and left us to do the work until he comes back again places enormous moral pressure on the church to give evidence that our kingdom narrative is not a fantasy. We have to give some incarnational evidence that what Jesus was about is being advanced through his people. Now, sometimes what Christians argue about is the extent to which the kingdom is only seen in the church versus whether we should look for broader social transformation. Sometimes it seems like all we can hope for is to keep from things getting any worse than they are. There's not a lot of transformation, it's just kind of holding back the flood. And so you have some ethicists who just want to reduce everything to the church, some who want to talk about just kind of holding back evil, but others who have a more kind of hopeful, even aggressive vision of gaining victories for the reign of God. And that's the vision that appeals to me. I do believe it's kind of both and. I tend to be a both and thinker. So I'll leave you with this. How about the vision of a church in which the inner life of the church bears witness to the reign of God breaking in, in which a quality of community and a kind of moral practice is visible, people can say something is different in that community, but also in which individual Christians or groups of Christians are involved on their own and in partnership with others in seeking to gain ground for the reign of God in all kinds of sectors. Some are doing domestic violence work, and some are doing hunger and economic development work, and some are working on climate, and some are working on peacemaking, and some are working on the criminal justice system, and some are working on the tax structure, and some are working on healthcare, and some are working on the ground relief ministry. Whatever it is, they're always aware the kingdom looks like deliverance, healing. Some are in healthcare, by the way. Deliverance, healing, rebuilding of community, justice, peace. And they get to catch glimpses of God working through and in all of that work and seeing the smiles of what happens when people say yes to the kingdom and breakthroughs are won for the kingdom against all kinds of odds. This is kingdom ethics, and this is the vision that I think can empower a church in any social setting to be about what God, what Jesus was about in his ministry. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Chris Marshall, and I've been on the committee that's been helping to organise David's visit, and I've been asked to just offer tonight's response to this lecture. Unfortunately, I can't be here tomorrow night. I've got to go to Christchurch for the day, so I would like to offer some thoughts about perhaps how the lectures I have heard find their point of integration and convergence in the things that you've reminded us about so helpfully this evening, David. Just on tomorrow night's lecture, it's same time, same place, and it's on the subject of same-sex relationships, which is one of the great sort of moral debates, certainly within the Christian community, but within the wider community as well, that we have today. And David is going to lead you. I won't be here to be led, but to lead you in thinking through that issue again. There's also a seminar tomorrow midday at 12 o'clock at 8 Kelvin Parade, on evangelical politics in America today, which is, of course, endlessly fascinating. And now, I hadn't heard David's lecture. I do know the book, Kingdom Ethics, and I'd really recommend it to you. I never like books coming out in a second edition because it means your first edition has suddenly become redundant and you don't know quite what to do with it. But it is an excellent book, and many of the theological students who've been using it in this country have been doing so because I've recommended it over the years. So I wasn't really clear on how David would tackle that subject tonight, but I guess I knew from his work and from him the sort of things that he would want to draw to our attention. And it did strike me that many of the things that he's covered in his previous two lectures and seminar and associated seminar do really find their point of meeting in his theme tonight, which is that Christian ethics can only really claim to be authentically Christian insofar as it is faithful to the memory of Jesus. insofar as it helps to produce a way of life that looks like Jesus and that echoes the dominant message of Jesus about God's kingdom. And those very helpful seven marks of the kingdom that David mentioned, I've reduced it in my lectures to three marks of the kingdom, so that's a wee bit easier for students. But it's the presence of God's power, it's the presence of God's, it's God's presence itself, and it's the creation of a people. And I think David has very helpfully put some detail on that. This idea of Christian ethics finding its integration in the life and teaching of Jesus came to my mind several times during David's previous lectures. As he mentioned, his first lecture was about the witness of the righteous Gentiles during the Holocaust. And one of the things that he labored was that only a certain kind of Christian faith, not Christianity in general, but only a certain kind of Christian faith was capable of generating a willingness to rescue Jews from Nazi persecution. And I found myself thinking a couple of things as I listened to him. One was, I wonder how many European Christians in the 1930s and 1940s asked themselves, what would Jesus do in this situation? And if they did ask themselves that question, and this is not a new question, Christians have asked this question since the beginning, if they did ask that question, how, I wonder, would they have answered it? What was Jesus doing to the Jewish people at this time? Judging and punishing, or calling us to rescue and to redeem? The other thought I had, even more powerfully, was perhaps the failure of otherwise good people to save the lives of a vilified minority tells us as much about the corrupting and intimidating spirit of violence as it does about their moral character. It must have taken huge courage to oppose Hitler and his henchmen. Whence comes such courage to resist the utter terror that is induced by mass violence? I mean, we all like to think that were we there, we would have known what to do. But just think of the terror that you feel in a nightmare and wonder how you would cope if that was confronting you on a day-by-day basis. At the very heart of Jesus' proclamation and embodiment of God's kingdom, at least as I read it, lies his confrontation with, his exposure of, the demonic and deceitful nature of the spirit of violence itself. Peace, as David reminded us, is one of the marks of the kingdom. And for me, violence is not just one ethical theme amongst many that Jesus deals with in his ethical teaching. I think it's a master theme that unites his entire mission, from the wilderness temptations to Caesarea Philippi to the Garden of Gethsemane. It's a theme that helps to understand the saving impact of his death and resurrection. And for me, perhaps the ultimate explanation for the failure of Western Christianity to defend the victims of Nazi persecution was its long-standing and profound compromise with violence, and particularly with the violence of the state. As long as it can be theologically imagined that God authorizes and uses political violence to achieve his purposes in history, it's very much harder to answer the question, what would Jesus do? In his second talk, David considered the question of what value does faith add to public witness or to a Christian contribution to public life? And he argued that one of the things that faith does is it helps us to steer public debate beyond utilitarian and consequentialist reasoning to consider some of the deeper normative principles and moral values that are at stake in the debate. And he used, as he mentioned this evening again, the use of torture by the US authorities in the post-9/11 environment. And in mounting a Christian critique of torture, David and David and his co-conspirators, I don't know what quite you'd call them, your group, your team, offered a number of principled reasons as to why it is always wrong to torture. And the five that he mentioned was that it violates human dignity. It breaches the nature or the principles of justice and mistreats vulnerable victims. It puts too much trust in the power of government to use its power righteously. it dehumanizes the perpetrators of the abuse and it erodes the moral character of the nation. He explained that one of the audiences he was addressing when he wrote this article on why torture is always wrong were his brothers and sisters in Christ who were in the military and intelligence agencies and who found themselves morally conflicted about the interrogation techniques that were being used. And he gave them in this article in the Declaration, Evangelical Declaration Against Torture, a firm moral basis for opposing the merely utilitarian consideration of whether it works or not. The thought I had on this lecture, which again brings me back to Jesus, was whether those self-same criteria, those five principles you picked out, actually also militate against any taking of human life, which is the ultimate affront to human dignity for utilitarian reasons, for some other benefit. I found myself talking to somebody just the other day about the story in John 8 when Jesus defended the woman caught in adultery. And you'll remember that he first squatted down and started doodling in the dust. And we have no idea what he wrote, and it doesn't stop commentators from guessing. But we have no idea what the significance of this action of his was. My guess, though, is that he was parabolically reminding her accusers of humanity's creation by God out of the dust of the ground, and the fact that it is God who gives the spark of life, and only God has the right to take life. There are no exceptions to the taking of life, just as there are no exceptions to the torturing of victims. Then in his lunchtime discussion on Monday with church leaders, one of the things that David commented on was that while Christian public witness is necessary, it's an art that needs to be learned and needs to be done well. Some of those present, and there may be some people here today who are at that session on Monday, spoke of how they felt Christians in New Zealand society were now being actively excluded from the public table. They're no longer welcome. And I again found myself just pondering whether this was the way I saw things or not. And to me, the issue that we face as believers in this society is not so much one of overt hostility, I don't think anyway, as it is one of a complete lack of knowledge about the character of Christian faith. I mean, Maori spirituality is increasingly prominent and accepted, so why not Christian spirituality? Because people don't get it anymore. They don't understand it. First Peter talks about being ready to give an account to everyone who asks you about the hope that is in you. Presupposes that people want to ask. Why would they ask? Because they were hearing and seeing things that surprised and offended them. They were seeing, no doubt, the moral action that gave expression to the God's kingly work in the world. Today, in our country, people aren't asking us because we just ain't that interesting anymore. And that's our problem, it's not theirs. So rather than lamenting the loss of our privileged position in society, perhaps we need to ask why people are no longer intrigued by who we are and what we do, and by our irrepressible hopefulness. Give account of the hope that is within you. Again, it takes me back to Jesus. You are the light of the world, he said. No one after lighting a lamp puts it under the bushel, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. I saw a glass of water here somewhere. Where is it gone? All right. Now, tonight's lecture, Remembering Jesus, focused on the kingdom as we remember Jesus proclaimed it. The Gospels really present us with the knowledge of Jesus as he was remembered by his followers. We have no other access to Jesus other than Jesus as he was remembered. The Gospels are intended to enable us as his followers down through the ages to remember him. But of course, in truth, as David was saying at the close of his lecture this evening, in truth, we have more often actually forgotten Jesus than remembered him. We've suffered from what Lee Griffith calls the great amnesia. It's not that we've forgotten that Jesus existed. It's not even that we've forgotten what Jesus taught. But what we have forgotten is the true meaning of his life and the true purpose of his ministry. Seems clear to me that from the New Testament, the first Christians looked to the earthly Jesus and to his teaching as their definitive role model for daily life, and the results were striking. And one of the results that was most impressive was their complete relinquishment of violence and coercion. The New Testament nowhere speaks of believers carrying or wielding swords. The one time it happens, it is severely denounced by Jesus. Subsequent Christian theology, however, has been remarkably reluctant to take seriously Jesus' role as a normative role model for his followers. It's both questioned the ethical feasibility of doing so, because Jesus is divine after all and we are merely human, and it's feared the theological consequences of reducing Jesus to a mere moral example. But the world has paid a very high price in blood and tears for this reluctance to take the memory of Jesus seriously as the thing to which we are accountable. The church, in the interest of orthodoxy and political power, has raised armies and waged war. It has tortured heretics and burned witches. It has persecuted dissenters and compelled conversions. Christ, again, as David reminded us tonight, has functioned more as the central link in the doctrine of individual salvation than as a primary source for Christian values and praxis. The church's creeds, interestingly, are all but silent on the ethics of Jesus or on the ethics of the kingdom. Not because I don't think they believed in them or practiced them, but probably because they didn't need to be reminded of them at that early stage. But it's helped to encourage this great amnesia, this forgetfulness about the normativity of Jesus' life and teaching for the community that bears his name. It's allowed us as the church to be seduced by wealth and power and violence and to forget what our distinctive vocation is in the world as those who name, those who give witness to the work of God's kingdom. As simple as it may sound, it is the memory of Jesus and the continual reference to him as the normative role model for Christian conduct that is the single greatest antidote to our seduction by worldly power and ideologies of every kind. Martin Niemöller, the great German Lutheran pastor, attributed his opposition to the Third Reich, which in some senses was slow in coming, but when it came, he resisted the Nazi regime. He attributed that opposition to his own simple motto: what would Jesus say about this? What would Jesus say about this? He survived 6 years in a concentration camp, and towards the end of his long life as a peace activist, he declared that the only question that really mattered to him was, what would Jesus do? Remembering Jesus, taking seriously what Jesus would do as our touchstone, is the thing that will bring us into contact with this this commitment that David has reminded of us of this evening, to bear witness to be instruments of, to be those who recognize and name the work of God's kingdom in this world. So thank you, David, for your very helpful lecture, and especially, I think, for those seven marks of the kingdom, which do help us to recognize where God is at work, not just in the church, but also in the world. I wonder if we'd like to come back up here and give you a chance to answer some questions that might come from people in the audience. So if you have a question, please ask it. I'll probably repeat it for the sake of the tape.
Let me just say thank you very much, Chris, for another very, very thoughtful response. And if I could add one thing, it would be, Christians are to be people who remember Jesus, who are constantly immersing in his teachings and example, or constantly being drawn back to his teachings and example. What the kingdom piece adds is, you might say, the overall framing of what his project was. The reclamation of this entire rebellious world, and the specific points at which you might say God is most offended by what we do. Injustice and violence and crushing people and excluding people from community and all of that. So the kingdom frame helps the teachings of Jesus to be located in a broader narrative, and the narrative is God's reclaiming of the world. And it also helps us to not succumb to other frames like the narrative of solely individual salvation or something like that. The God's project is bigger than that. So, happy to answer any questions.
Yes.
Thank you very much for this. I think it was a really nice distillation of what the kingdom means. You've taken it and put it in a practical framework, but it's still quite a few steps away from what it is we actually need to get out and do. I mean, the kingdom requires us to go into action, and I'm curious to hear what you think about how we translate the characteristics of the kingdom into what is it that I or we need to, how do we feel about, you know, what is the kingdom response to this issue?
Mm-hmm.
For that issue, and how is it that we still let out, because it's still a high level.
That's a great question, and I would say that every context and every moment raises different questions of application, right? So what that looks like in Wellington, New Zealand in 2015 looks different from 100 years ago and looks different from the US or whatever. And it is, I think it's a collective Christian project to discern what application of kingdom practices and kingdom principles looks like. We're best when we think about it together, but it would be a very helpful enterprise, you know, for every congregation. I'm gonna imagine my dream world. Everybody buys the seven marks of the kingdom, and they say, we want our church to be about this. And so then you have reflective, prayerful conversations about, well, how do we actualize rebuilding of community in this, you know, this community, and how do I do that at work, and how do we do that in this part of Wellington, what about this, and what about that? And so I think it's something that thinking about it collectively would be the best way forward. I do think it's possible to speak of being a kingdom person in individual life, in the sense of how one conducts oneself in at work and in public life and going about one's daily business. Certainly it looks like being a reconciling person and being somebody who's concerned for justice and fairness and somebody who's always looking to include those who are on the margins and somebody who's looking to see where people are distressed or hurting and looking for healing. Where does somebody need to be delivered? You know, so there's, I think it's fairly close to operational, but the steps to specific practices, or even what policies look like the best steps to move you from here to there, that's a whole different, it's kind of another level of communal reflection, but I think every community should be doing that reflection. And by the way, it's easier to agree that we're about peace than to agree, or about justice, than to agree on what every specific policy measure would be that would look like that. You might have, this looks 53% and that looks like 47% better than, or the worse or whatever. So, but I'd love to see more and more Christians asking those questions. And I think doing it together.
David, you hinted at the kind of enduring nature of the kingdom. N.T. Wright said that to participate in building the kingdom is to do something that can last forever, mm-hmm. which seems like quite a lofty attribute for a human action. Would mm-hmm. that be something that you would identify with, that kind of description?
I think it's a beautiful idea that, and another way people have said it is, no effort for the kingdom is ever wasted. if it is God's eschatological project, and you might say it's building the new world that God is bringing in, then in some way our humble efforts to advance the kingdom, I don't think they're just left behind or wasted. I think they are transfigured and brought forward into the coming reign of God. The good thing is, you know, there's a lot of dignity and joy in doing kingdom work, regardless of what we think it's all going to look like in the end when Jesus comes back. You know, if you help bring reconciliation, or you lift somebody's face out of the dust where they've been being mistreated, that's just good in itself, and you know it when you do it. But I agree in principle with N.T. Wright there that if this is what Jesus left his community to do, that no kingdom efforts, no faithful kingdom efforts are wasted. I think they're drawn up into the coming great day.
Mm-hmm. What we're talking about now is basically debt with other dimensions. Why, I think there's lots to do with why it faded out in terms of social, political, what we're talking about, mainly power relations. And I think the life of Jesus, we can learn a lot about his power relationships, being God, the walk among us, and the power relationships about how we deal with the people around us, who we deal with, but often not discussed. And just referring before about meeting with the church leadership, what about all the lay people, you know? Mm-hmm. I don't come, I live in Auckland, but the whole thing around our society, it's a lot to do with us here now, power, knowledge and all that.
Mm-hmm.
But how can we sustain this new movement?
Thank you. Let me pick up on a couple aspects of that. The social gospel movement that was birthed in the late 19th century, early 20th century, especially in Great Britain and the U.S., but there were some continental voices as well. And in our setting, Walter Rauschenbusch was the biggest name. Went a long way towards recovering the kind of vision that I'm talking about here. Everybody should read the works of Walter Rauschenbusch. F.D. Maurice was another one who was kind of a precursor to some of this. Emphasizing the social gospel of Jesus, the social implications of Jesus' message, challenging a merely ecclesial or clerical understanding of what Christianity was about, or even sacramental. The social gospel movement had certain problems, I think, of over-identifying the advance of Western liberal democracy with the gospel or with the kingdom. Yeah, sometimes socialism as well. So that, and there were people who were concerned about whether theological orthodoxy was compromised by some of the moves of the social gospelers. But the new kind of resurgence of kingdom theology in the last, say, 20 years, it really comes out of fresh exegetical work and biblical research, as well as the post-World War II effort to reconnect Jesus to his Jewish origins, his Jewishness, and not to have this Europeanized kind of Gentile Jesus. And so when you connect Jesus to his Jewish origins and you then listen for Kingdom of God language, it takes you back into the deep wellspring of the Jewish tradition. So I think that the new focus on the historical Jesus and his kingdom message, which has really taken off through a lot of people, not least of which is N.T. Wright, has been an advance that maybe shows some sticking power. I also see the ways in which it is inspiring a younger generation of Christians who were ready for a renewed vision of what the Christian faith was about. So I'm hopeful there.
Thank you.
Yes, I have a little bit of trouble, so I hope I'm not covering ground that I've already been.
Sure.
But I have a concern to ask, as far as community is part of the kingdom of God, can community ever be acquired unless Christians are prepared to really learn about, to have proper knowledge and respect for other religions? For instance, I have a granddaughter who has spent 2 weeks in a Buddhist monastery, and she happened to also be there at the time of the Nepal earthquake, but fortunately she came out of that. But now she's in India, presumably looking at the Hindu religion. She also did religious studies as part of her university degree. So she is interested. She's a leader in World Weavers, which is seeking world community. And can this be ever achieved unless we can respect, understand, and respect other religions?
I was struck by, thank you for your great question. This is really about Christian engagement and interaction with other religions. If you actually look at the Hebrew Bible, it's interesting, the hopes of restored community that you find in the Hebrew Bible sometimes sound more like everybody is welcome in the mountain of the Lord at last on equal terms, and the barriers begin to fall and we're just a community of human beings together. But other times it sounds more like everybody is welcome at the mountain of the Lord, Mount Zion, and everybody adopts, you might say, the worship of Yahweh, and you basically everybody becomes Jewish, right? So one way to have world community is for everybody to believe like we do, right? That would be lovely, right? But that is what many Christians hoped for a long time, that the evangelization of the world would ultimately look like the triumph of God's reign by everybody coming to believe in Jesus or believe in Christianity the way that we do. And it's interesting that that hope seems to be less attractive, especially to the younger generation. And their hope seems to be more of a hope of, as you're suggesting of your granddaughter, weaving connections among the peoples of all the different world religions and seeing if you can find a common community without a common religious belief, or maybe finding some commonalities that might be there, but it's not about everybody becoming Christian, it's about us respecting people for what they are. And I think this is a very interesting issue in Christianity today. We don't send out a lot of missionaries anymore, and there's a lot less of a kind of a confidence that that the way redemption will happen in the world is if everybody believes what we do. The kingdom message that I've been laying out does make a space to recognize what God might be doing through other religions and through other peoples and those who are working towards kingdom goals. I still would say, and this may mark me as an older person or something, I'm aging rapidly. I'm afraid that if everybody takes the path of mainly focusing on interreligious kind of dialogue, and also I'm going to take a little bit from this religion and a little bit from that religion and a little bit from that religion and weave together a kind of a garment of faith that is my own eclectic creation, then in the end, the coherence and power of every particular religion ultimately gets weakened. In any case, I hope that 100 years from now, there are still vibrant, deeply Christian communities of people that are respectful of people of every other religion, but are still deeply practicing a vibrant version of Christianity, not a kind of a multi-faith pastiche, but instead, and I would hope that that would be true of Jews and of Muslims and of Buddhists and of others. In other words, you have to have strength in a specific religious community to even engage other religious communities with coherence. And I would like all of the world's great religions will remain vibrant enough to engage in that way, if that makes sense.
Jonathan.
We heard a very passionate plea from Chris for an emphasis on nonviolence. And I'm reminded that tomorrow is the day say a little bit about compromise. We face in our daily lives and public life clashes of values, gospel values. We have to make choices, sometimes very hard choices. There are some who say we need to take up arms to us, and others to say, as good as that, that man doesn't
lie. Right.
Peace must be the primary, non-violence must be the fundamental. I just wonder if you might comment briefly on the broader issue of compromise. So I just wonder if there's something about capitalism.
These seven marks of the kingdom are only ever approximated by any human being, and collective efforts are even more an approximation. Never perfect, always striving. If you have a healthcare system that works pretty well, you can always think of something that could make it work 7% better, 8% better. If you have a criminal justice system that delivers justice unevenly, you could always make it a little bit better. Any piece of legislation that gets through most of our parliamentary bodies contains, you know, half a dozen things that are good and 5.3 things that are bad, and maybe it's worth it because it's a little bit more good than bad. Purist thought in the public arena ultimately crashes pretty quickly because of the way power is involved and differences of perspective. Glenn Stassen, on the issue of violence, my co-author Glenn Stassen was more unequivocal than I have been in never, ever endorsing any use of violence from a Christian perspective. I, having cut my teeth on studying the Holocaust, have always been aware, I'm sure you know Glenn was too, but both of the evils of aggressive violence against innocent people and of the need of people to be able to defend themselves against aggressive violence. And that if somebody wants to murder a community's women and children, that it would be better if there was somebody to prevent those people from murdering that community's women and children. And that as soon as you begin to grant that might be better than the alternative, not as good as neither of those things happening, then you're beginning to get into the space where you're thinking about defensive violence. Now, the vast majority of the uses of violence in human history have been unjustifiable. And most of what people claim was defensive violence was certainly questionable. And most of our wars have been stupid wars. But I think that one can make an argument, as just war theory at its best has done, that there are times in which the demands of love and justice involve interposing a force between those who would victimize the innocent and the innocent who are unable to defend themselves. It is a compromise, in a sense. It's not, it doesn't clearly reflect the unequivocal pursuit of peace, but you might say it reflects deliverance of the oppressed or those who would harm them, at least provisionally, until you can get to a better place. So that's why I'm not a pure pacifist, but I really do not dissent from what Chris was saying about the vast majority of the uses of violence in human history, and also the way in which violence becomes a kind of power in itself, a demonic power that sweeps up everything in its midst, including a lot of times the way defensive violence becomes demonized and just as quickly. So that's an honest rendering of where I am on that issue. Some hands over here if you want to. Right.
And then we participate in that.
Right.
And I guess my question is whether you see our role as hinging on being connected to God.
Yeah.
And being able to, participate from relationship with God.
Yeah.
Or whether there's ways in which we can be agents in bringing about the kingdom without any, maybe, awareness that we are doing so, or without connection, or guidance, relationship.
That's a great question. I think that there are people who, for whatever reason, are not in a living relationship with God, maybe because they've been turned off by what people who bore the name of Christ did or whatever, and so they're unable or unwilling to become believers. But they've picked up some vision, some aspect of that moral vision that I've been talking about. And so they're your secular human rights activists or your secular conflict resolution specialists or whatever. And they're able to do kingdom type work without a living relationship with God. They've picked up the principles, but not the spirituality. I think that's second best. I think that what we should be striving for in the church is a community of people who love Christ, who have a living relationship with Christ, motivated and rooted in prayer and worship and community life, and who are collectively, prayerfully discerning, hey, what does kingdom work look like for us right now? And making decisions that are spirit-led and spirit-empowered, and can participate in a dimension of the supernatural power and strength of the Holy Spirit that are not available, you might say, to those who are not in that kind of a relationship. I do think for major social efforts, social justice, peacemaking, whatever efforts, there's usually coalitions built that involve both people who are practicing Christians and people who are not, and that's great. It's fine. But I think that if you look at the overall teaching and message of Jesus, I mean, he was a praying person. He taught his disciples to pray. The early church was deeply spirit-oriented and prayerfully oriented and had all kinds of charismatic and ecstatic experiences of God's presence, and that helped to empower them to create a kind of community that was transformative where they were. And so that's what we should be going for.
Just one more question.
Yeah. Right.
And at present it's being used a little bit as a method of exclusion. And I'm interested in how that kind of concept cuts across the kingdom approach of inclusion and welcoming people on the margins.
Yeah.
Should the tension even be there?
What a great question. The Church of the Regenerate. Every community does have to have some idea of who is in and who is out and what the boundaries of the community are. The church has always struggled with identifying the marks of regeneration and who's got it and who doesn't and what do you do when they don't have it. And the interesting thing about a kingdom agenda is it doesn't so much focus on that as it does focus on a shared vision of what we're trying to accomplish. So in a sense, the invitation is something more like, do you believe that Jesus is who he said he was and that his project is the project worth pursuing in the world? Do you want to be a part of doing kingdom of God work in the world? You're invited. Come join the team. And we will train you and we will help you get ready for the labors of the kingdom. And if it looks like you're not quite ready, we'll keep working with you and we'll keep sifting, helping you sift out what doesn't fit and get equipped with the approach and the tools and the spirit that is needed. But it's like the focus is much more outward on what we're trying to do together and what God is trying to do in the world, and much less on kind of overly introspective examination of whether people have all the marks that we might be looking for. If they want to join the kingdom project, we want them, and we're going to try to work with them and put them to work in that. And so I like that if your vision is a kingdom-oriented vision, you want as many sorry for the military metaphor, but you want as many troops on the field as you can get, and you're not overly focused on excluding people who may or may not quite qualify because of whatever assessment you have going about regeneration. Eventually, in the life of the church, there are times where somebody's behavior is so in violation of basic community standards that you have a problem. But I think that may be different from what you're talking about. You know, I would say that the vision I'm talking about here, the kingdom vision I'm talking about here, is not universally shared in Christianity. There are many, many other master narratives, you might say, of what people think the Christian faith is about. And so the vision that I'm sharing doesn't cohere easily with some of the visions that are out there, including the one I think that you're suggesting is out there in your community.
There's one more question at the very back.
And I was keeping in mind a beneficiary friend of mine. And all of those that Chris mentioned, that you from your lecture, kinds of violence have been enacted on her by our governments and society. And sometimes they're made worse by well-meaning people who act out the charity model to bring healing, you know, some of those seeking.
Right.
Working with people to get us more skilled to be furthering the kingdom.
Right.
In ways that don't interrupt and integrate people's human dignity.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not quite sure that the church is very practiced in that. It might be because of some of the other master narratives that you just referred to.
Mm-hmm.
That we're out there to rescue people rather than to empower and truly heal them.
Yeah, the danger of all deliverance and rescue narratives especially is it assumes a certain kind of powerlessness on the part of the people that you're rescuing. Like, I often would tell the story about the time that I was about to drown off the east coast of the United States in North Carolina. I was 13 years old. I was about to drown. I did not really need a lot of empowerment efforts at that moment. I needed somebody with a good, strong swimming stroke to grab me and pull me to safety. I literally needed to be rescued. There are moments where people literally need to be rescued. I mean, from death, from addiction, or for all kinds of things. But yet, for the longer term development of, for example, economic self-sufficiency, rescue is not the best model. You need empowerment and self-sufficiency and all kinds of things that you learn slowly over time are the best ways to help a community or to help a person, while, you know, so that you're not always rescuing somebody, right? And so that's all part of what you learn. But the overall goal is still no poverty, nobody starving to death, you know, and so on. The goals are the same. The means to the goals you learn how to pursue through practice. And many Christians have reinvented the wheel time and time again, not having learned from prior efforts in the social arena, and kind of keep making the same mistakes until things get relearned, and then they get forgotten, and you do it again in the next generation, right? But the vision I'm offering here, I hope, is a vision that can be appealing across the board. It invites people into not just a saving relationship with Christ, but a relationship that participates in the saving of the world that Christ wants to do. And that saving is holistic, and we all have a part. And I hope that you have found this compelling. But mainly, I hope it'll send you back to the Gospels, back to Jesus, and a renewed commitment to, as Chris said, doing what he said, living how he lived, and anchoring your life there. So thank you for coming out this evening. I appreciate it.